नित्यानंदाय स्वागतम् सर्वधर्म प्रणेतारम् सच्चिदानंद रूपिणम् वंदे सनातनम् पूयम् नित्यानंदाय स्वागतम् वेद वेदांत संवेद्यम् देव देवी स्वरूपिणम् वंदे वटपलाशिस्थम् नित्यानंदाय स्वागतम् वेद वेदांत संवेद्यम्
सदाशिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां। I welcome you all with my love and respects. Today we will enter into the next sutra of Patanjali. Patanjali's next sutra gives us the deeper insight about avidya. He gives us deeper understandings and method. Sometime we may think, why so much of importance on same concepts? Why the same concepts are again and again and again repeated? It is repeated because we don't listen. We may hear, but we don't listen. Today's sutra works on our deeper consciousness, on the deeper level, on the same truth. Deeper level, but the same truth. So let us enter into the sutra. Avidya kshetram uttaresham prasupta tanuvichinna uttaranam. Avidya kshetram uttaresham prasupta tanuvichinna udaranam. Swami Vivekananda's translation is, ignorance is the productive field of all those that follow, whether they are dormant, attenuated, overpowered, or expanded. Ignorance is the productive field of all those that follow, whether they are dormant, attenuated, overpowered, or expanded. Prabhavananda's translation says, ignorance creates all the other obstacles. They may exist either in a potential or a vestigial form, or they may have been temporarily overcome or fully developed. And Swami Sachidananda translates as, ignorance is the field for other mentioned after it, whether they may be dormant, feeble, intercepted or sustained. The idea Patanjali is trying to convey to us through the sutra is, ignorance is source of all obstacles. Avidya is source of all obstacles with which we are struggling, suffering, whether the obstacles are dormant, unconscious, or weak, very feeble, or overpowered, or expanded, whatever it may be, whatever may be. Please understand, avidya, ignorance is the source, is the field in which all the other problems grows. It's a very unification truth, the truth which unifies, truth which can be applied in any system, truth which can be applied in any with any problem, the truth which unifies everything. Before getting into the sutra, I just wanted to share with you all something, some wonderful question which I received. I'm continuously receiving questions from media, devotees, ex-devotees, and from all corners of the world through internet. And I am sitting with a small group and sharing my responses so that it can reach to the world. Through YouTube we are uploading. Yesterday I was talking about some of my deep experiences, some of the techniques, methods I downloaded during my 53 days in the prison, some of my insights, the techniques I downloaded. And one of our devotee, Dr. Krishna, he brought some questions and some of the beautiful connections. Whatever I was revealing based on Hatha Yoga, he was corroborating with the medical science. Based on medical science, we had a question in yesterday's question answer session. I thought I'll share this question with you all and give the answer here, because this question is directly related to this sutra. Avidya kshetram uttaresham prasupta tanu vichinnodharanam. This sutra is directly related to this question. If I answer this question, you will have a lot of clarity about this sutra. The question is, do psychological diseases like depression or insomnia have a physical component also? Not only depression and sleep disorders, insomnia, even the aging, all three of them are directly connected to a chemical called melatonin. Yesterday, Dr. Krishna was sharing with me. All the three were directly connected to melatonin, which is directly related to Ajna Chakra, which is directly connected to pineal glands, Ajna Chakra. See, depression, sleep disorder, aging, all the three are directly connected to this one chemical, melatonin, and directly connect, that chemical is directly connected to Ajna Chakra. They were asking me, is there any solution, Swamiji, for this? Upanishad is providing solution. You may think, how Upanishad is providing solution for depression and sleep disorder and aging? There is a beautiful Upanishad called Kathopanishad. If you understand the story of Kathopanishad, you will understand how the truth related to this question is delivered in the Upanishad. The Upanishad says, Nachiketa, young boy, was given to the Lord of Death, as a gift by his father. He was depressed because of father's curse. Father says, just let you die. He was depressed, but suddenly he was possessed with a sincerity, shraddha vivecha. He was filled with sincerity and he says, I will face this death. I will go through this process. I will take my father's curse as my life and go into it. Understand, whenever, whatever you think as curse happens to your life, be ready, be sincere. You will get into the second level of understanding. When life slaps you with what you think as curse, you have two options, depression or expression. If you are sincere, it can just lead you to higher consciousness. Nachiketa, fortunately, his mental setup was such, he was so sincere, he was able to face it, handle it, live that curse. Suddenly, just he opened himself and because of his sincerity, openness to the cosmos, he goes to the doorway of Yama, the gateway of Yama, Yamadharma, Lord of Death, and 3 nights he sits there with deep patience without sleeping, and Yama appears 3rd day, and Yama asks, what do you want? You came as a guest, what do you want? And Nachiketa asks for the boon of the science of enlightenment. And Yama gives him 3 boons. 1, when he goes back, the parents will accept him. 2, the special method of reaching the heaven. 3, the science of enlightenment. This is the story. If you just understand this whole story, you will understand some of the deep truths. First, Nachiketa is in depression. But he adds sincerity to depression. He is not letting the depression to depress him. He is adding sincerity. The moment he adds sincerity, his sleep disorder is converted into tapas. 3 nights he was not sleeping. Sitting at the Yama's doorway, sleep disorder, insomnia, is converted into tapas. Understand? Let me describe the sincerity. Exact meaning of sincerity is having deep patience and passion to know the truth. Nachiketa had deep patience and passion. Because of his passion, he waited for 3 days, Yama to come. If he doesn't have passion, he would have said, oh, he's not there, let me go back, it's okay. Maybe after a week I'll come back, or I'll take an appointment and come. No, he is sitting, fasting, without sleeping. He had patience to wait. He had passion to wait and patience to wait. He had both passion to wait, patience to wait. If he did not have passions, he would have been shouting, fighting with the gatekeepers. Come on, allow me, I have to see Yama. If he's not here, at least give me his cell phone number or mail ID. I'll have to inform that I am here. Did not have impatience, had patience to wait. And same way, passion to wait. He did not go away. Sincerity means having deep passions and passion to know the truth. He was waiting. So, his sleep disorder has become tapas. Then, Lord of Death gives him the science of anti-aging. The aging reversal happens. Nachiketa is one of the great Siranjeevis. Understand? All these three, depression, sleep disorder, aging, all the three problems were solved by one technique, sitting patiently with patience and passion. This is the technique used by Nachiketa to move from depression. The depression, when you add this technique, means sitting with deep passion and patience. This is the technique. When you add that to depression, depression becomes yearning. When you add that to the sleep disorder, which is an outcome of depression, that becomes tapas. Krishna says very beautifully, yogis do not sleep when normal men sleep. Three people do not sleep in the night. Yogi, bogi, rogi. Yogis do not sleep in the night because they will have to meditate. Bogis do not sleep in the night because that's the time to enjoy. Rogis do not sleep in the night because they can't. All three cannot sleep in the night. Krishna says very clearly in Gita, yogis does not sleep when common man sleeps. Means the sleep disorder becomes tapas. Same way, when the same passions, same sincerity is added, when you face death with same sincerity, he gives you the signs of enlightenment. Sitting with patience and passion is technique to awaken Ajna Chakra, which is responsible for this chemical melatonin. So what Nachiketa went through is the experience of melatonin. His sincerity, when it was added to depression, it became yearning. When it was added to his sleep disorder, insomnia, it becomes tapas. When it was added to the death, it becomes the technique for anti-aging. So all three are directly connected to the Ajna, directly connected to this technique melatonin, the chemical melatonin. And another important thing, this chemical's color is black, darkness, the color of death, lot of death. Once light comes, this chemical evaporates, this hormone evaporates. So death, lord of death, Yama, never appears in light. If the light is brought into your system, he is not there, he will not be there. What Nachiketa went through is solution for all these three problems, and all three are directly interconnected. Depression brings insomnia. Insomnia makes you age quickly. If you want to get into the process of anti-aging, if you are interested in living without sleep disorders, if you are interested to be out of depression, learn the science of creating melatonin, awakening Ajna. Ajna Chakra, awakening Ajna Chakra takes care of all these three. It's a direct solution from Upanishads. Direct solution from the Vedic tradition for modern day problem. Maybe when we look into each Upanishad's insights, inner meanings, deeper significance, all our modern day problems can be directly addressed. Avidya, which is source of all these problems, ignorance. Avidya is the source of abhinivesha, clinging to life. Yesterday we understood the truth about clinging to life. clinging to life is directly responsible for aging quickly. I've seen with my own experience, people who don't take risk, the civilizations which does not take risks, too security-based civilization, goes on only saving, 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 saving. I'm not saying saving is wrong, but saving has become obsession in Indian civilization. You can see any common Indian, a normal middle-class Indian, and whatever I'm talking is a fact, he will be at least saving 40% of his income for future, or having that kind of a wealth stored for future, or he will be at least having the intense tendency for saving. Means our Indian civilization is like you have to save for your 7th generation, only then they will give you the shraddha after your death. The concept of rebirth has made Indian civilization as a saving civilization. Economically, it is great, good. And one more thing, we are the country who have the habit of owning the house. Most of the developed countries do not own the house. Bank owns it. For 30 years, they go on paying mortgage. They go on paying mortgage. We only have the habit of owning the car and house completely. That is why majority of the Indians, please understand, majority of the Indians take birth, live and die in one city. And 12% of Indians do not cross their district in their life. You will be shocked to know these details. 12% of Indians do not cross their district before their death. Means stable life. We don't take much risks. Too secured. Too secured. But the Western civilization, they take lot of risks. Once in 3 months, they change the house, car and husband. House, car and spouse. All three are changed once in 3 months. Lot of risk. Lot of insecurity. Lot of new happenings. See, that is the reason we look old, lot older by the time we reach 45, 50. By the time you reach middle age, your face, the whole thing looks like you are old. If you see in the Western countries, a person of 70 years, and if you see Indian of 45, both will feel same. Both will feel psychologically and physiologically. Aging gets quickened when you are too much bothered about security, when you don't take risks, when new openings are not happening in your life, when you are not learning the lessons from the big happenings in your life, when you want all the laser beams which creates illusion in the air to be under your control, aging happens very quickly. Not taking risks, not getting into life, not letting the life to appear in front of you with all dimensions. You see, if you are not saving, it's too much of risk. But you see, the developed countries, even though they have a huge economical crisis because of this non-saving habit, see, most of the youth in the Western countries, the developed countries, do not own single penny. They make to pay the credit. They make to pay the debt. Already the loan is there. They make money only to pay the loan. By the time they finish their life, they would have paid maybe 90%. And not only even the mental setup, my last check should bounce. That's the mental setup. Means there should not be anything left. Why should something be left? Let us blow it away. But with the Indian mental setup, see, for country, for economy, it is great, no doubt. But the personal mental setup of not taking the risks makes you age quickly. The aging process is quickened. People who take a lot of risks, people who constantly play with life, play with different options, I can see very clearly, whenever the spiritual truths are shared, the developed country people are taking more risks, applying these truths in their life and experimenting with it, are changing the way in which they think, making a big shift in the lifestyle is very easy for Westerners. But somehow, that Indian cozy lifestyle middle-aged people, even if God appears in front, they will ask him to come to their house puja room. They will not come to his place. If he says, come tomorrow, I'll bless you again. Can I have your photograph in my puja room and do puja there itself? Will you appear there and bless me? Not taking any risks. Not doing any big change, shift in the thinking style or lifestyle or way in which they exist. That is a mental setup of safety-based civilization, saving-based civilization. Of course, this attitude of saving does a lot of good to the country. That's different. But saving with intelligence is okay. Saving with deep insecurity brings saving and diseases to spend the saving. By the time you are old, you will have money and the reason to spend money, the disease to spend money, both will be there. What's the use then? All I am trying to tell you is, aging is directly related to the feeling of insecurity. Constantly trying to keep your life safe, secure, clinging to life. I tell you, I am telling you honestly, very directly I am telling you. Whatever has happened in my life this last few months, this scandal, has really, really, really taught thousands of things, not just to me, to the millions of my disciples. Really, I taught them all that not to cling to life, not to take things for granted, experientially. Not just verbally, experientially. The science of abhinivesha is taught to them experientially. I am really telling you, I am now sitting and working with all my disciples, their courage quotient, that's the new word I am working on, courage quotient, the way to think and approach the life, how it was before and how it is now. I know many of my disciples before, even if one small phone call or trouble is enough to shake these fellows, now nothing touches them. What more can happen to us? Come on, leave it. I could see what suffering can teach. Of course, it's a very hard lesson, but because of their sincerity, the millions of disciples who stayed with passion and patience for me to come back, 53 days. Who are waiting. You see, if they did not have passion, they would have been taken away by the cyclone of scandal. If they did not have patience, they will not be waiting. They would have carried with their something else. people were waiting like Nachiketa. And just now I heard, few days before, there were many disciples from Tamil Nadu came and literally sitting outside the prison, day and night, doing puja, guru puja, and lighting camphor, breaking coconut, meditating for me to come out and give darshan or give one word, bless them. Just the other day, I was getting the news from our devotees. I was shocked. Of course, I mentioned about this just to honor their devotion. I'm indebted to their devotion. There's a beautiful description of Krishna and Shiva in Bhagavatam and the Tamil Devaram literatures. That person who can be bound only by devotion, nothing else can bind him, only by devotion. So I tell you, I am bound to their devotion. I am bound to all your devotion, like Nachiketa, having passion and patience and waiting for 53 days. Nachiketa was only 3 days. And every day I am receiving letters from devotees around the world. Millions of them really had insomnia, sleep disorder, in these 53 days, did not sleep, were crying, just completely down. But because of their sincerity, when the sincerity was added to their depression, depression became yearning, and their sleep disorder became tapas. Now they will have the science of enlightenment, the anti-aging process. Clinging to life makes you grow old quickly, takes away the joy of life. The big problem is, the biggest problem human beings face is not knowing that they don't know. The biggest problem of avidya is it will not let you know you are in avidya. It will take care constantly that you will not feel you are missing something. That is the quality of avidya. That is the quality of avidya. Understand? The avidya starts, it says very beautiful. The sutra says, ignorance is the field where all problems starts growing. Avidya is the source where all problems are created. Just yesterday we were analyzing how all the gora, means the perversions, starts happening in the system. First, the structure, architecture of the cosmos, the macrocosm and microcosm is one and the same. The architect who created this cosmos only created your body. Same science, same technology, same method, same formula. When a critical mass, means the cells become molecules, then on the molecules the super consciousness starts reflecting. So many molecules gathering, put together, becomes an organ. And different organs put together, becomes body. The most important thing is each molecule is independently intelligent. Each organ is independently intelligent. Each part of your body is independently intelligent. Understand? To every thought you have, all the molecules respond. For example, you have a thought of anger. All the molecules will have a election, quick election. Some part of your organs will say, no, this anger should not be expressed. Some will say it should be expressed. Some will say it should be suppressed. Some will say it should be expressed. But finally, your decision happens. Your decision cannot be satisfying all organs or all molecules. So naturally, whose voices are not heard, they are little hurt. Just like election, just like democracy. If your voice is not heard, if you are not successful, if your person is not sitting in the seat, you will have the dissatisfaction, grudging, grumbling. So that dissatisfaction is suppressed by the person who makes decision in you. Your ignorance only makes decision. Avidya makes decision. That decision-making authority not only makes decision, executes, and tries to suppress all the opposite voices. If constantly some organs' voices are not heard, opinions are not heard, they just decide to go on a non-cooperation movement, that is what is disease. Understand? That is what is disease. For every thought, each molecule in your body responds, each organ responds, and when your ignorance makes decision, naturally some part of the organs' voices are rejected and suppressed, sometimes condemned. So the suppressed, condemned organs and molecules, how long they will put up? After some time, raise their voice. Of course, in all abusal, how long people will put up? Will raise their voice. Will at least answer. So, even after the answer, if some parts are not attended by your decision-making authority, which is avidya usually in all human beings, then they decide to go on a non-cooperation movement or attacking back. If they decide to go on a non-cooperation movement, that is what is failure of that organs. If they decide to attack you back, that is what is cancer. Understand? So there are some certain thoughts. When you decide based on avidya, many of your own organs and molecules do not support, do not respond, strongly resist. But because of your ignorance and arrogance, you go on with your decision. Going on with your decision, even if you are organs are not agreeing, you are heading towards hell. That is what I call acquiring karma. What is the best way then? What is the solution, Swamiji? What is the solution? Because any thought, some organ, some molecule will not accept. Always election, always democracy means chaos. How to handle, Swamiji? One important method, secret, is make all decisions from unclutching. If you are unclutching continuously, all the organs are handled with friendliness. See, with no vested interest, any leader can gather all parties together. If all people know that he doesn't have any vested interests, they will completely surrender all their opinions. They will not go for voting or protesting. They will just surrender the opinion, and they know whatever he decides will be good for us. So let your consciousness give that guarantee to all the molecules and organs in your body. By the deep unclutching and infusing friendliness into your system, give that comfort, give that friendliness, give that loving zone to all your molecules and organs. Suddenly you will see all the people have surrendered their votes at your feet, and they are asking you to make the decision, and the decision is unanimous. Coming to the state where the unanimous decisions are made in your system and making decisions is living enlightenment. Whenever you make decisions unanimously, without contradiction, with all your organs and molecules standing by you, you are living enlightenment. Means you have infused enough of friendliness in your system, feeling safe, secure in your system. So every molecule, every organ is just responding the way in which you want, without opposing, resisting, protesting, attacking you back. A person who creates that kind of an organism in his body is Buddha, enlightened, who teaches that science to the world is Dhamma. That science, and it is shared with the world, is Dhamma. Who is successfully able to create that kind of an organic community, that community is Sangha. Understand? Creating a deep friendliness inside your molecules and between your organs makes you Buddha. Ability to teach the truth, when the truth is expressed to others, it's called Dhamma. When the truth is made as an experience to many people, and that kind of an organic community, when it is created, that is called Sangha. All you need to do for all these three is go on making decisions from the zone of unclutching. As long as the contradiction is there in you, unclutch. Let the decision pop up by itself in you. You will see it pops up. You are intelligent enough to deliver decisions, to deliver strategies, to express the clear understandings. All you need is patience and patience to unclutch and be in the Vidya zone. Avidya is the kshetra for all conflicts. That's what here Patanjali says, whether they are dormant. That's what. See, when in this example, understand, sometime some of the molecules in your body and some of the organs in your body, their resistance is dormant because they are afraid to raise their voice. Even if they are able to raise their voice, it may be weak, feeble, as now happened. He says, Tanuhu, feeble, or it may be scattered, the voices, opinions may be scattered. See, when it is weak, they need mic. When it is scattered, they need friendliness. Or maybe they are strongly active. Sometime even the active voices create conflicts in you and becomes cancer. That is why I tell you, make all decisions by infusing deep friendliness in your system. Even if you are defending yourself, you will not have the internal conflict and you will not create disease. It will be a unanimous decision. It will be please understand, people are asking me continuously, Swamiji, you go on teaching compassion, 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 but Krishna says in Gita, fight to Arjuna, what should we follow? Understand, Krishna infused deep friendliness into Arjuna. Even his fight was unanimous decision of all his molecules and organs. It was unanimous decision. He did not have internal fight. Krishna cleared everything. Then anything you do will be good for the world. Infuse deep friendliness into you. Infuse deep energy into you. Infuse feeling safe and secure feeling into you. Then anything you do will be good for the world. You will not do, you will not be abusive, you will not be violent with anything. It's a very powerful truth. That is why I feel sympathy towards the people who go on cherishing so much enmity towards me and my mission and vomit that venom and poison in thousands of ways. They do not understand many of their own molecules and organs are not accepting their thoughts and decisions. And they are suppressing those organs and molecules. Those organs and molecules whose voices are being suppressed. You see, when they have the anger and violence and vengeance, venom, vomiting, enmity, vomiting towards me and my mission, many parts of their own body, many of their own molecules are not agreeing. But these guys, because of avidya, arrogance, are feeling insecure. They go on vomiting this venom and rubbish and suppressing the voices of scattered and feeble voices of the organs, sometimes even the strong voices of their own molecules and organs. How long you can suppress? It will just bounce back as cancer. It will just protest and bounce back as cancer. That is why whenever I get the news that this person is abusing you and your mission, Swamiji, this person is vomiting poison, this person is vomiting enmity, vomiting venom on you and your mission, Swamiji, whenever I hear all these things, first thing I feel is sympathy. Oh God, poor guy. This is what I mean, acquiring karma by abusing the master. I will never curse. I will never curse. This Nityananda Purnima, I was in prison. That day I was in prison. That morning I was walking. I was told only in the evening, that was Nityananda Purnima. Morning I was walking. Suddenly I felt such a alive, fresh, joyful energy and the strong remembrance of Arunachala. Very strong remembrance of Arunachala. It was such a strong remembrance and overflowing compassion and love. I was walking like Kal Bhairava. And if you have seen me walking during the Kalpataru Darshan, the Kundalini session, how I walk, just like Kal Bhairava, I was feeling and walking. I felt such compassion. I just saw very clearly in me. I was telling, I forgive everybody who is related directly or indirectly in this whole conspiracy. And none of them will have any karma from me. I will not give any curse or karma towards them, to them, any bad karma to them. I was in such an ecstasy and compassion, I just blessed, released such a compassionate energy. I came back to the cell and sat. I saw Bhaktananda was sitting and writing something very sincerely. You will be shocked. Whatever idea was crossing my being, and whatever I was uttering, exactly Bhaktananda was writing like a telepathy. You will be shocked. Exact words. Like a telepathy connection. He was sitting in the cell and writing the whole thing. The moment I started telling him what I was experiencing or expressing, he said, Swamiji, that's what exactly I was feeling. And penning down, I said, stop, now don't read it out to me. I will tell you whatever I was feeling, just you do the proofreading. And we did the proofreading, not a single spelling or verbal mistake. We have a record. Whatever I was feeling, see, it was felt with such a unanimous way, the person who was standing, being around me, not only this part and organs and molecules, even his organs, molecules, were in same tune, tone, started reciprocating and responding to that same idea. Such an unanimous decision. I tell you, I'll never curse. But the poor guys, because of their own self-conflict, see, your body is like a mirror reflecting the super consciousness. If some part of mirror decides to separate from the piece, if it breaks itself from the main part, then you will have many reflections of the same light. For example, if the mirror breaks in different corners, same reflection will reflect, same light will reflect in many corners. Many reflections will appear in that light, in that mirror. Many reflection in one mirror is ugly. Many decisions in one body is dangerous. For example, if your negative karma gathers too much of momentum, and that part will start taking decisions, doing things independently, that is what I call being caught by Brahma Rakshas. Being caught by Brahma Rakshas. You will think and decide in one way, and one part of you will be thinking and deciding in some other way. Most dangerous. Abusing master is Brahmahaddi dosha. When you do that Brahmahaddi, Brahma Rakshas will be catching you. This is the exact truth. When part of you is not in tune with what you are doing, that part gathers momentum and naturally creates diseases, depression, sleep disorder, and finally aging, means quickening the process of death. Avidya is the root of all these problems. Vidya is the solution for all these problems. Continuously make decisions in an unclutched way. Not only your body will be making unanimous decisions, even the people who live around you will be making that unanimous decision. Living with people who are making unanimous decisions along with your body language, without even you need to tell them verbally, is heaven. I tell you. That is what I call Sangha. That is what I call Sangha. So, unclutch you will become Buddha, you will radiate Dhamma, and you will create Sangha. This is the essence of today's sutra. Avidya kshetram uttaresham prashupta tanuvichinnodharanam. From ignorance, the productive ignorance is the productive field of all those that follow, whether they are dormant, attenuated, overpowered or expanded. So I sincerely, humbly request all the people who are cherishing enmity towards me and vomiting poison towards me and my mission, please relax, infuse friendliness and compassion into your system. Do not have insecurity. I am here only constantly to radiate compassion and love, only to utter Abhayam Sarvabhudebhyo. I give refuge to the whole world and understand, infuse the same peace into your system. Let your system heal, because any violent anger, vengeance, decision you make and vomit poison towards me and my mission, many part of you, the molecules, organs, will be resisting, and that resistance will naturally will become a momentum and will become a protest. Not only protest, will become strong opposing diseases. Do not waste life with these conflicts, contradiction and diseases. Life is valuable. I respect life, whether it is mine or yours. Let us respect life, whether it is mine or yours or my disciples. I tell you, come out of avidya and clutch, infuse friendliness and compassion into your being. Make your whole being take unanimous, peaceful, compassionate, loving decisions with peace and restful awareness. Let you all experience and radiate living enlightenment. Let you all live, experience, achieve and radiate the eternal bliss, Nityananda. Thank you.